Welcome to my friend Goldrush. I'm Lost Wolfe. This is episode 6. We're in Rio de Janeiro, and this is basically where we left off. The prominent landmark in this famous port is called the Sugarloaf. What an odd name, but anyway. So we're in Rio now. Every person on board is looking forward to going ashore. You have been like a caged animal on the ship for nearly 6 weeks. Ships of every kind, brigs, barks, brigantines, schooners, clippers, steamers from nearly every country come and go. Whaling, cargo, passenger, and even slave ships come and go. And that's sad, you know, that we did that to other people. The stay in Rio normally lasts about 10 days. Could be more, could be less, depending on the extent of the repairs. During this time, supplies including coal, wood, fresh water, and food are replenished. Small repairs are made, and the ship is prepared for the next leg of the journey. The fruit here is plentiful. You manage to secure more of the fruit to which you attribute your good health. And again, if you didn't have the fruit, you would possibly die. There's still a potential death here, because you might get a random cholera death, but we'll see. This is fine. Well-protected southern... This is a fine, well-protected southern harbour, which makes it a favourite stopping point for ships preparing to round the perilous Cape Horn. Just south of Rio, the captain advises you that you have crossed the Tropic of Capricorn, that invisible line on the globe at 23 degrees 27 minutes south latitude that separates the torrid zone from the south temperate zone. Most passengers on board have little use for such trivia, but it is reassuring to know that you are making progress. Rumors are starting to spread about the difficult times you are going to encounter in a few short weeks. You hear horror stories about getting around Cape Horn. Passing the 45th parallel, the temperature begins to drop. Passengers begin spending more time below deck. When you left Brooklyn, it was the dead of summer. It seems to have slipped everyone's mind, at least until now, that June is the dead of winter here. The freezing temperatures are making this painfully clear. The captain's varying age, experience, and wisdom. But all captains, no matter what their background or experience, approach the Cape with great respect. They all realize they are extremely vulnerable to the elements. As you approach the southern tip of South America, the captain advises all persons aboard that the sea you are about to encounter attains a degree of violence unknown in any other part of the globe. You are in the midst of a terrible storm, and the ship is taking on water. Everything that wasn't absolutely essential to the continuation of the voyage has just been thrown overboard. Fortunately, the gold coin was in your pocket, so you still have that. Jake's letter, along with the gold flake under the stamp, was in your hip pocket, so that is still with you. Your family... Pardon me, it's pretty late here. Your family photo was in your pocket, so you still have that. Everything else now belongs to the raging sea. Okay. I don't think it's past here because there really isn't much else to see. You're gonna see the island again. It's out there in the distance, but there isn't much else to see beyond this. So, onward we go. Just before rounding Cape Horn, the captain points out the deceit rocks, which are coloured white from the bird droppings. Rounding the cape from east to west is not an easy task. If all goes well, it is usual for a sailing ship to allow 3 to 5 weeks to get to the west side of the Horn. Winds in the area of the cape rarely blow less than 45 miles per hour, and almost always from the west. Gales in this area easily pick up a schooner and smash it into the rocky shore. The raging seas and the temperature of melting ice. You scarcely get 6 hours of daylight. When there is light, it is of little benefit. The overcast hugs the seas, and visibility is very low. Again, this is wonderful writing. I'm really genuinely surprised. It is not uncommon for it to snow here in the summertime. The captain is continuously looking through his looking glass, keeping track of the ship's progress and position. He also makes entries in his log religiously. Nowhere is navigation more difficult than in these waters. Some sailing ships would take 70 days to round the cape. Some ships would turn back because of the damage the sea had done to them. Some ships would not make it at all. Occasionally you see floating wreckage and debris from less fortunate vessels. Okay, so while this is happening, there's a couple of things that I can collect very quickly, which I'm going to grab now, because it would behoove me to do so. Sorry about the screen shake, by the way, but developers thought this was awesome way back when. There's a paperclip lying on the floor. It must have been tossed there by the storm. You pick up the paperclip and put it in your pocket. This is a very sturdy paperclip. There's one item we will not be able to get, but we'll be able to get it later. The lowest level of the ship falls with water, and the ship is on its way downward in some of the most frigid water in the world. Look room. Okay. Thinking that the string might come in handy someday, your pocket and take it in your pocket. When there isn't a storm yet, when the Cape Horn isn't here and you look at the bunk room, you would see the string. It's just somewhat iffy programming on the developer's part. You're in the depths of the ship. This is the lower deck. You see coal hall doors and a boiler. There is a wooden stick resting against the wall. The workers don't mind if you take the stick. After all, it's just a useless old stick. This is what is left of the shovel the workers used to the boiler room. Oh, okay. I was kind of hoping. Okay. Well, maybe it's up one. Might be here. Considering all the work that goes on here, the area stays surprisingly clean. There are a few metal scraps lying on the floor. You scoop up the metal scraps, being careful not to cut your hands, and you put them in your pocket. You have a handful of metal scraps that you collected when they're around the engine. Oh, interesting. It didn't actually show me a picture of the scraps. There we go. Oh, okay. Weird. Alright, so we've got everything we need except for one item, and I'm gonna move us to the next scene. With rounding a Cape Horn, also called Cape Stiff by many sailors, because of the difficulty of rounding it behind you, the captain steers the steamer north by northwest. It is everyone's goal to reach the port of Valparaiso, which means Paradise Valley. To any Spaniards and folks and friends from there watching, I am so sorry that I'm mangling these names. As the temperature rises, so do your spirits. Off the coast of Chile, the ocean is swarming with sea cows. A little further off the coast in Chile, about 400 miles to be exact, is Juan Fernandez, the island most often recognized as the island on which Robinson Crusoe was actually exiled in 1704. Every person on board has been looking forward to arriving in Valparaiso. They have been in close quarters for too long. The port of Valparaiso is shallow, so the boat is anchored offshore. People go ashore and supply support aboard by a continuous stream of small boats going back and forth from the shore to the ship. While ashore, people nearly kill for a current newspaper to read, but the word is confirmed. And they do this thing, and I hate it. Don't do caps, folks. This is all the good writing that you were doing is now eliminated by this one capitalized sentence. Gold has been discovered in California. We get it that the protagonist is supposed to be overjoyed at this news, but you know, keep it in context. We waste no time, and this is also weird. They flip from kind of third person to sort of weird second person here. We waste no time in loading the ship with only that which is absolutely necessary and head for California. The only excitement today was crossing the Tropic of Capricorn for the second and last time on this voyage. The unbearable heat isn't far away again. When a captain sees another ship, he always knows what kind of ship it is. None want flag it sails. There goes a British full-rigged three-master. Saw an interesting sight today. Flying fish. Fishing has become one of the favorite pastimes, especially since the weather has warmed up. Those who don't partake in the fishing enjoy watching for whales and porpoises. On the west side of South America, the crew anticipates arriving in California and begins putting things in order. The crew is busy scrubbing the deck, chopping off rust, painting, and polishing. Most of the passengers who were keeping journals at the beginning of the trip have stopped by now. But throughout the entire trip, people have been reading whatever they can get their hands on. Many days aboard a ship are spent in utter monotony. There is nothing to do. At least, nothing you feel like doing. But watch an occasional ship come and go. Watch the sun rise out of the water, move across the sky, and then set into the water again, day after day after day. The last leg of the journey is slow and seems to drag on forever. The walls seem to be moving in. You are positive the ship was only half the size it was when it left Brooklyn. Moments of solitude and privacy are non-existent. Fellow passengers who, only a month ago, were easy to get along with now seem impossible to tolerate. Fights break out over trifles. There is constant bickering and gossip. Before, you complained of having the same food to eat meal after meal. But now you would gladly eat anything. Provisions are running dangerously low. This is the one adventure segment that we get in this particular run here. And what you have to do is you have to assemble a fishing line so you can fish. I've got most of the pieces for that because if you don't do this quickly, you do die. Food is running out on board the ship. Everyone is suffering. One man has already died. Okay, let's go get the only thing that we need to finish off our fishing rod and friends. You grab yourself a nice slab of pig meat from the steaming pig. That piece of pork sure does look tasty. Okay. Whatever you say, Jared. As you can see, I've already played this through because I played and wasn't recording and felt silly right afterwards and knew I had to do this again. So we're going to eat the fish, the meat. As soon as you sink your teeth into this piece of meat, you realize something terrible is about to happen. That pig is some type of disease that poisoned the meat. It looks like your trip is over. And you kill her, like literally. The disease doesn't take long to just whack you and kill you dead one time. Oh, goodness. Oh, game. You are fantastic when you want to be. Oh, now, fortunately, in this particular game, there's not a whole lot you need to do to get fishing. You just type fish and off you go. Well, you've done it. You've found the perfect place to fish, and you have everything you need to do it. You pull the string you found in the bunk room out of your pocket, and attach one end of it to the wooden stick. The other end you attach to the paperclip. You tie the metal scraps from the engine room to the string a few feet from the paperclip. And last, but certainly not least, you gladly take that piece of pork out of your pocket and carefully place it on the paperclip so that it won't fall off. With great anticipation, you lower this makeshift apparatus into the churning sea. And surprisingly, you get a fish. You don't have to do anything here, Jared will simply do the work for you. Reel it in and all that good stuff. Once again, Jared, you have saved the day and the lives of those around you. You reel in the catch of the day and share it with your companions. Now you all make it to California. The captain has given the word that you are only a few weeks away from the coast of California. This seems to calm everyone's nerves. The arguments and fights subside. As the ship nears California, you begin to forget the hardships and tough times you've just endured. The promises made to the Almighty while rounding the Cape are all but forgotten. Somehow, those times don't seem as tough now. Much more important now is the topic of nearly every conversation on the ship, where people plan to go to search for gold, how they're going to get it, and what they're going to do with the gold, the fortune they have discovered. There is also much fretting and worrying about arriving too late and missing out on the best opportunities. Hopefully, there will still be plenty of gold left when you get there. For the crew, no portion of the voyage is without danger. They must maintain their vigilance to the very end. You're fortunate that the ship has a sufficient supply of coal to make it to California. Other steamers ran out of coal. When that happened, spars, doors, bunks, and portions of the deck were ripped up and fed into the firebox to keep that ship moving toward the gold fields. The ship is now approaching the Golden Gate, and your journey is approaching its end. The dense fog makes it difficult, not to mention dangerous, to find the entrance to the Golden Gate. All hands are on deck as you approach California. To the gold-seeking passengers on board, it is the long-awaited promised land. Everyone cheers for the captain as he guides the ship through the Golden Gate. The shoreline is covered with lush green plants. What a beautiful sight. The bay is filled with boats of all kinds from every country. The boats and ships are too numerous to count. It looks as if they are stacked on top of each other. But they seem to be deserted. Everyone on board is sure they are too late now. Energy levels run high among the prospectors on board. They know there is no time to waste. The captain takes you across the bay and up the Sacramento River. Somewhere here we've lost 2 points, I'm not sure where. Oh, actually, we lost 7. I wonder if you need to do this particular, the fishing thing, right at the very end, and then it gives you the points. Don't give up. Well, at least it didn't say I was right on track. My god. Okay, so it's going to take us to the same screen. I have another save game. In fact, we will get the message very quickly, and I'll just show you. I have another save game because, like I said, I had to play this before again because it didn't record. You've been on the ship long enough. Go ahead and disembark. So I have another save game here where I actually got all 95 of the points. I believe that's because I did the fishing trip at the very last moment, but I'm not sure. So tomorrow, what we'll do is we'll pick up Gold Rush. We will start a new version of the journey. And I will take you through that. And then all roads lead to California. And in California, of course, you've got to find the stagecoach. So I'm going to try and save 3 versions of the stagecoach setup. So we know that we've got a stagecoach. Because if we don't, that means replaying. And no one wants that. So I will see you all tomorrow. Have a great evening, folks. And good night. This is Lost Wolf signing off.